So get ready, and for the first tech session, I'll be calling the technology specialist from Node Experts team. She is a very wonderful and intelligent coder. Well, let's call upon Sapna Upreti. Please welcome.
Thank you, Akshay, for such a wonderful introduction for me. So, good morning, guys. So, actually, I'm a little bit sick today, so pardon me if I fumble somewhere. So, let's start it. So, about me, I am Sapna Upreti, and trust me, I'm a very good singer. Actually, I just missed one word in that. I'm a very good bathroom singer. So how many of you are singer here or sing? It doesn't matter how well or bad you sing, just singing. How many of you like singing? Actually, I'll not ask you to sing here, but just I want to know. Oh, that's great. So we can talk about it later. So after this meetup, so we can discuss which kind of songs you like or not. Apart from that, I like coding in my free times or love shopping. Obviously. And about my professional summary, I'm a full stack developer at the Node Expert, as Akshat already mentioned about the Node Expert. So, we are a small group of JavaScript lovers who love to do challenging tasks. Apart from that, we are very good at building fast and real time applications, and we have done some tremendous work apart from Node.js. In the AngularJS, D3JS, MeteorJS, ReactJS, and many more. And also, as I think Akshat already told you, but just it feel proud. So we are also an official partner of the Meteor. So let's not talk much about the Node Expert. We can also, you can contact any of us regarding any queries regarding Node Experts. So let's begin with this session. I'm here to present a talk on the Node.js. When I first started working on the Node.js, actually I started working directly on the Node.js after my graduation. So, so I was very excited about it because it was new that time and very popular among the web developers. So, when I so the first question arises in my mind is was that rise in my mind was what is Node.js? Then I read it somewhere that it is just a JavaScript implementation on the server side. So I thought that let's start with the JavaScript first before going into the Node.js. So what is JavaScript then? I read from the Google or somewhere that JavaScript has event loops, callbacks in a stack, asynchronous, single-threaded, non-blocking, and many more technical terms like this. So it got me a lot confused that time. So and one more concept that came in that I read that time was V8 engine. It uses the V8 engine. So only Chrome uses this engine. Other other browsers uses their own engine, but their architecture and their processing is somewhat similar. So I started my journey like this. I just Googled, I just read from somewhere, I researched, and I experiment while researching. So one of the coolest thing about the JavaScript is that we can experiment while we are researching without having any runtime environment or without starting any server or without any text editor. You can just, if you have read somewhere that this find function does this, 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 just copy that code and open your browser console by pressing F12, paste there and enter. You will just see the result in milliseconds. So that's the best part of the JavaScript that I've seen. So what does all this concept mean? Trust me, everything in the JavaScript, whether we are running in the browser or in the server, everything revolves around this event loop. So before going into this event loop, I'll first try to explain you what is the structure of the V8 engine. I'll just go into detail into V8 engine only because the Node.js uses this engine for creating a runtime for on the server. So let's begin with this its architecture. Sorry guys, I'm a bit sick, so I'll just take few seconds of yours. So, so So let's begin with this. So it has something called heap. So heap is just a memory allocation for the variables or whatever we declare in our code. Like you have declared an array with around 100, 200 or whatever size. So all that will goes inside the heap memory. So what this stack here? So what this is also a memory, but what will it does? It will contain all the methods or whatever the code you want to execute during the runtime. So all the executable code will go inside this stack. I'll explain you more about this stack in the coming slides. So let's check out this. What is this web API? You know, when at the beginning of my work on the JavaScript, I just thought that these timeout events and all the events that JavaScript uses, like button, click event, blur event, whatever all the events are, I thought all these are part of the JavaScript libraries. But that was all false at that time, because the browser uses this web API to call that timer event or whatever the button click event is. So it calls the web API, these events are got that there, and the callback is written to the callback queue, and the event loop will handle this. I'll explain you more about this, so don't worry about that. So let's begin with the stack first. So what is stack call? So how many of you are aware of the stacks? Stack. What is stack is? So stack is just the first in, last in, first out in the memory. So when we are calling any function, it just goes inside the stack, and when that method completes its execution, it just pop out from that stack. So I'll just show you it's working through this example. So let's take this is our main program. Here we are calling a few one. Inside that few one, we are calling few two, and inside this few two, we have console.log hello world. So how this stack will work now? So first the main program will get called, and after that the few one will get called. So few one will check that it has few two execution. So then it will goes inside the few two, and after that finally we will have a hello world printed. So what will happen when it completes its execution for the hello world? It will just pop out that hello world from the stack, and next it will pop out the few two, then few one, and then main. So I hope you get the basic idea of how this stack thing work on the JavaScript, right? So what happened when we run code synchronously, single-threaded, in a single-threaded environment in the JavaScript? As I have already shown you in the previous slide, that was the synchronous code execution. But here I'll take some complex example, like we are requesting http://xyz.com in the first request, then second request. We are just console log. So it is synchronously in the single-threaded environment. So what will happen? First, request 1 will proceed, and then it will wait for the response. If you have applied any loader, then the loader will shown in your site. And if it will take around 10 minutes, then it will wait for the 10 minutes. This will happen in a single-threaded environment. But this is not the thing which happens in the JavaScript, isn't it? You know that. It doesn't wait for any. If you have clicked the button, then it doesn't wait for that button to be responded. Right? So what happened? So then how JavaScript work asynchronously then? So the answer lies in, as I have already told you in my first slide, that everything in the JavaScript, the answer, whether it is related to callback, whether it is related to asynchronous nature, or whether it is related to its non-blocking nature, everything lies inside the event loop. So how does event loop work? So I'll just show you an example by running a program. A smart guy named Philip Roberts built this program so that we can, he just simulated how the JavaScript work on the background through this program. So I'll just show you how it work in synchronous and asynchronous manner. Okay. So I've already told you about this call stack. Let me just stop somewhere. So I've already shown you an example of this. it is, here it is a call stack, web APIs, and a callback queue. So what will happen that we all know that it execute everything line by line. So first, it will check for the button click. So it will just pass this button click event into the web API. If we are not clicking that button, then nothing will happen to our code. So next, it will just print the hi, and then welcome to this meetup, then thanks for coming here. And after that, it will print the welcome to Node Expert. So let's run this. So what is happening here? It just goes to the web API, then we are, then call stack is printing that. It is executing, and it is just popping out that. So if we have something asynchronous then, as I have already told you that everything in the JavaScript which JavaScript uses, it's asynchronous call. So this set timeout event has a callback. So here comes one concept, callback. So I'll just give you a brief about it this time, and I'll show you an example of that in the later slides. So what is callback? Callback is just an executable code which we are passing to another code as an argument, and which promise that it will return a callback. Callback means it will execute, but after a span of time. So here, I'll just try to run this set timeout. So what will happen that, just wait for this set timeout. It will not execute that 10 lines of code, which is inside the loop, inside the loop, inside the loop. If I have not used that callback here, if I have not used this callback here, then what will happen is that this part of code will block this part of code from further processing. So when we are using the callback, it will run after that. As you have already seen that, it goes inside the queue, right? Is it clear to all? Or we are trying to make this session interactive. So if you have anything, you can ask me right now regarding this. Is it clear? So let's move on to the slide. So by now, I hope that all of you are clear about how the JavaScript one work on the browser, right? So let's move on the Node.js. Then JavaScript is that part. Then what is Node.js then? Node.js is just the server-side implementation of the JavaScript. So it just provides. So now we can run the JavaScript on the server side. So it just allows us to run the JavaScript on the server side, which is outside the browser. So how it does that? Anybody want to answer here? How it does that?
Please raise your hand.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
Please take this one.
Actually, as you told in the first slide, mm-hmm. JavaScript is just the V8 engine mm-hmm. and the web APIs that is provided by the browser, right? So right. In the server side, what actually happens is it utilizes the V8 engine, that is the heap and yes. the stack, that is necessary for a programming language to run. Apart from that, Node, the lacking in JavaScript was that it does not facilitate us with any file system. Means inside the browser, we don't have any access to our file system. You cannot write or read a file in your browser. So that was the demerit in JavaScript. And Rialdon started then, he just took out the web APIs that man shown in the slide, mm-hmm. okay? And then put some file system APIs inside along with the V8 engine, and that what's made Node.js.
Yes, he is right. What's your name?
Ashok.
Ashok?
Yeah, Ashok there.
Ashok. So, he's right about that. It Great. Uses the V8 engine runtime. As we all know that every code need to be interpreted and well executed for to be run on the on any server or anything. So Node.js uses the V8 engine for providing that runtime. Apart from that, Node.js also provided us a huge number of libraries which we can use free of cost. So we don't have to write any code for that. So where these libraries are managed? These libraries are managed through NPM, which is Node Package Manager. So what this Node Package Manager does is that it allows all the developers over the world to share their code so that the code is reusable. For example, we can say that like you want to integrate Stripe API. Stripe, everyone is aware, I hope. Yes, so payment gateway, if you want to integrate, then we can simply use, we don't have to write all the API handler for Node. We can just simply NPM install that. So NPM allows us to install the libraries globally or locally. We can just use -g or -global to install the any package. We call all the libraries as package. So Node.js comes with two things. That is, one is runtime, and the other one is the libraries. Don't you think it's awesome? Right? Don't you think?
Yeah.
I can't hear anyone, all of you. So I think...
Totally awesome.
Yeah. I think you are all low in energy in the morning only. Huh?
Don't worry, snacks will be coming very soon.
Yeah, Akshat is right.
Yeah, it's awesome.
So what are the features of Node.js? All the features which are inside the JavaScript are the feature of Node.js. So Node.js uses the asynchronous code to run fast and to run in the non-blocking manner. So as I've already told you what is blocking and non-blocking, just once go through here, I'll just go through these slides here. So what is blocking is? Blocking is when someone else or some other code is blocking our code to be for executing. So as I've already shown you in that loop example, that when this code is independent, this code is independent of this code, but it is still waiting for this code to be executed. So this is the blocking nature. But Node.js comes with the non-blocking nature. So non-blocking means we have just put that inside the callback and it will just goes into the callback queue and it will just execute this independent code from that dependent code. So where it goes? Anybody want to answer where it goes? Actually, it is written here. Yeah, event loop. So I'll just explain you how the event loop is different from the JavaScript. So let's take a look at the example. This time I'll show you an example with the Node.js. There's Ashok already mentioned that regarding the file system. As Node.js, biggest advantage is that it provides the high input output if we have any application which require high input outputs, then Node.js, trust me that Node.js is the best for that. So let's take an example of the file system. So this is a library which Node.js provides, that FS, file system, for reading and writing files. So I'm just requiring that file system here, and what I'm doing is that reading this file asynchronously. What will happen, and I have already told you about the callback, right? So here is the example of the callback. So this part is the callback. This is the executable code which I am passing to this code. So in Node.js, the callback is slightly different from the JavaScript. In Node.js, the callback is the error first callback. So first argument which is passed through the callback is the error argument. So if you want to check whether whether this execution has error or not, then you can just simply check using the first argument, as I have already done here. So you can check that. If error, we are just throwing that error. So I'll just show you how this is working at the background. So let's check it out. So this is how our Node.js architecture looks like. So it has some user application is what we will build in the Node.js. And it has some JS standard libraries, which I have already told you about. And apart from that, it has Node.js bindings, V8 engine, which is written in C++. It has the heart of the Node.js, which is different from the JavaScript, relies inside this libuv. So what is this libuv? Libuv is just a program written in C, which directly contact with the operating system. So it consists of the operating system level method. So that is the reason that Node.js is very good for input-output networking and socket-related things, because it uses the OS-level method for reading file, for writing to the files for creating a new connection. So all the code which required that read file, write file, so it goes inside the libuv. So what will happen that whenever a Node.js requests for the read file, I'm just taking that example, which I have shown you in the previous slide. So what will it does is that it will just pass that into the Node.js binaries. This Node.js binaries will pass that into the libuv, and this libuv will just create a new thread. New thread here means it just fork a child process for that. It will just call that operating system level, which read the file, and it will does all these things in the asynchronous manner. And how it will do that? Through event loop. So what this event loop actually is? Event loop is just a program. They have just written a program which will call that loop until we have all the events which will get executed. So let's take in pseudocode example for that. Its pseudocode looks like this. While we have event to process, let's say E is the event which takes the next event. So this will pass that event requested by the client to a new thread. When the thread will complete its execution and it has some callback associated with this, then this will return the callback to the program. So I'll just show you another architecture for this, which will comprises of the event loop. So I'll just go with that example only. So we can also take the HTTP request example. So Node client requests for the HTTP server, it will just goes inside the event loop. It will check that, oh, it has some callback and it is requesting networking, file system or something like that. So it will just pass that into the libuv. Actually, this is libuv here. So it will create a worker process for that, like one file request goes into this, one is this. Like if one file that required to be read has 10 lines of code and the other file, I think we all are getting this out. So let's get back to this. So if we have one file which have 10 lines of code and the other file which we have requested to read has 100 lines of code, then if the both goes inside that, it will just create the separate thread for that. So the first one which will get executed is the one with the 10 line of code. So that is the biggest advantage and the biggest advantage of the Node.js. So let's move on to the where we can use Node.js. As every technology has some advantages and disadvantages. So where we can use Node.js? Node.js can be used where we have the less number of CPU cycle. The CPU cycle here means that we don't have a large number of the computation. Like if you want to process a loop inside loop, that what will it does? It will just block the processing from further execution. So next, for the input-output operation. Input-output operation means, as I've already told you, that it has some OS-level method for the input-output and for the networking. So it is very fast for the input-output operation. Same, it is used for the chat applications and the proxies, as we required a large number of connection for that. So Node.js can easily handle high level of traffic for the chat application and the proxies. So this is these are the areas where we can use the Node.js. So where we can not use the Node.js, when we have heavy computation, just opposite to that, where we have a large number of CPU cycles, we cannot use. If we have a large application, then we cannot use Node.js, as it does not depend on the multi-threading environment. So, but here is one thing, that if we have a large and complicated application, then we can just divide it into the several chunks and server, then we can do that work easily. But it is recommended that if you have a high number of computation, then Node.js is not suitable for that. You need to take an extra care for that. So advantages of Node.js. It is an open source. It is free to use. You don't have to pay for the license for using this. And it comes with the, as I've already told you, that it comes with the large number of libraries. So you can use that free of cost. So JavaScript languages. So the next advantage is for the programmer. You don't have to learn the two type of languages, one for the server and one for the client. You can easily use JavaScript on the server and the client. So it will increase the productivity of the that programmer, and it will also help in the code reusability. Apart from that, it is highly scalable both horizontally and vertically. Horizontally means you can include any numbers of node to your server, and vertically means you can use any amount of resources to your server. Apart from that, it is better. It has better performance than the traditional server, as it uses V8 engine, which directly compiles the code into the machine language, which obviously is fast. So, and it has a high, wide community of the developers. So if you have any issue, you can just post in the Stack Overflow. You will just get the answer within a minute. I usually get the answer within minutes. So I like to conclude that before starting any technology, like whether you are learning Python or Node.js, I think we need to know that the how it runs in the background, so that while working on the code, we just keep that in mind that it takes that much of memory in that process, so we can optimize our code while we are actually starting development. So that's it from my side. Hope you all enjoyed this, and hope you all find this interesting, and you get some idea about how JavaScript and Node.js work. So thank you guys. Any questions?
Those were interesting slides, I guess. Did you find it interesting?
Yes.
Okay. So any questions, then please raise your hand.
Yeah, sure.
Yes. Can you please speak your name?
Myself Parag.
Okay, now please ask
your question. What is synchronous and asynchronous mode of operation? I don't know.
Like synchronously, you are executing your code line by line, right? In asynchronous thing, that code will pass process, but it will not execute. Like I have shown you in that example, that using that callback, it will goes inside the callback, and when our stack is empty, you have seen in that example that when the stack is empty, it will goes into the stack and it will execute. This is how the asynchronous things work. It will not block your process from further execution. So I hope it answer your question.
Okay.
Asynchronous, it's like there are multiple threads, which is saying that it will not block the one request while executing the other, right? So is it like multi-threaded system?
No sir, it will just go inside the callback queue. So you don't have a main part which process your request, which execute your request. So you have that part in the callback queue. Whenever the stack will be empty, it will just push through that stack.
So how it is different from synchronous? Because suppose there is a loop, 1 to 10, and after the loop, when the loop ends, there is a statement to be printed. So this is also working like same stack, because the printing statement will be in stack, right?
Printing statement will appear after that loop.
Yes, so loop it will be in stack. So once the loop is over, then printing will be done.
Yes, but in asynchronous, that final statement will get printed first, and after that, that loop will get executed.
If I have written the statement, save code, how it will work asynchronous?
Okay. I can show you here. Here, if it is asynchronous, then it will execute this statement first, as it is independent of this. So this is how the asynchronous things work.
So first, welcome to node experts will be printed,
yes.
And then the loop will go.
Yes, loop will get executed. That's why it is not blocking in nature. It will not block your this process from further execution.
So how Node.js is differentiating asynchronous and synchronous? Suppose I have written the same code in Node.js.
Yes.
Will it be synchronous or asynchronous?
Asynchronous.
Okay.
Asynchronous. If you have passed the callback, then it is asynchronous.
So Node.js is by default asynchronous.
Yes. You have to pass the callback to make it asynchronous. Just in Node.js. Just does the thing differently for the file system, for the networking and software. It is for the child network.
Okay, very good, very well. Well, just reminding multiple questions from the same person takes a lot of time. Anyone who has any other question? Yeah, please.
That there is some, provide some error.
if you just disable your JavaScript, then you disable your create, you cannot run anything.
Mozilla, when you support...
Mozilla has something else, but it also provides a runtime. Mozilla has SpiderMonkey, and Microsoft has Chakra, and core JavaScript is used in the Safari.
So they also use some kind of runtime. They are just a minute.
Just a minute.
Yeah, as you said, it's not suitable for large applications or complex applications. So nowadays we are working in agile mode, and we don't know in earlier phases how complex or how large an application is going to be. So how we decide we should go with Node.js or not, because I think phase one, client is not that much clear about what he is looking for, but at a later stage, it's going to be a bigger application. So how we start with Node.js, because when application goes complex?
At the start also, you know the requirement of the project. By that requirement, you can check that whether it is suitable for the Node or not. Like if you have something related to content only, you just need to get the data from the server or from the file system, or you want to create the connections for that, then Node.js is suitable. As I've already told you that, Node.js can be used for the large application also, but you have to be extra careful for that. You need some extra care for that. You need to create chunks of server for that. So,
well, for more questions, we'll be taking it after the session or during the networking break.